Thank you for the introduction. So this talk is mostly about the III paper together with Markus Ulbricht, which he presented so this year. So it will actually be an extension of this talk. So if you heard it already, then you probably hear something new, or at least partially. And they will also talk a little bit about an even earlier paper from last year, because it contains some, let's say, related notions. Okay, so since Anne-Marie already introduced the main formal notions we require, so the main preliminaries, I will not talk too much about them, just in case you are just here, see this video just from a recording. So we mainly focus here on argumentation frameworks. So why are we focusing on them? Because they form essentially a common formal core for many argumentation formalisms in formal or in computational argumentation, like ASPIC plus, assumption-based argumentation, partially also diffeasible logic programming and others. And one main component are these kind of admissible sets. So for instance, here in the bottom, you see an argumentation framework with 5 arguments and some attacks between them, some direct edges. And for instance, the admissible set here is A, C, and E. So why? Because A is unattacked, C is defended by A against the attack from B, and E is defended by C against the attack from D, for instance. And here we'll mainly focus on exclusively focus on the catalyst point of view. So here the question is, for a queried argument, for a given argument, does there exist an admissible set that contains this argument? So can you, in a sense, coherently argue in some intuitive fashion towards the acceptance of this argument? Okay, and since we are talking about here about explanations, it is also, in some sense at least, reasonable to talk about what is actually an explanation. So I will not answer this question in general, because it's actually so there's a vast body of literature and vast body of research in several fields, for instance, in philosophy, psychology, and cognitive science. So I'm a computer scientist, so I don't know too much about these fields. But so there's an interesting article, it's in my opinion, by Miller in Artificial Intelligence Journal 2 years ago. And Miller essentially presented some findings to the artificial intelligence community, how they can or how they could potentially take advantage from these other fields when incorporating their explanatory forms. So we'll not talk too much about this here, but for instance, some of the major findings, they included explanations are contrastive. Contrastive here, for instance, can mean that if you want to explain P, you actually explain why Q, some other event, did not happen. And here, I think Anne-Marie essentially also talked about the two-letter things in just a slightly variant of this. So for instance, that explanations are social. So why are they social? When you want to actually explain it to some other, I mean, if you talk to humans, you want to, you have to be social in some way. And probabilist not mad is a bit put here in a provocative terms, is actually the same terms as Miller put them. But here, this doesn't mean that probabilists don't matter at all. It's just within explanations, it seems to be more effective to talk about actual causes. And now I will move a bit back from this general view. And now if you look at computational argumentation or explanations or tools of explanations in computational argumentation or formal argumentation, so at least my current view, and maybe you think differently or think the same, is that explanations in computational argumentation, they are still, so here it's still ongoing research, what actually is an explanation, what could be an explanation. And my personal view is that what we have currently, at least in the theoretical part, is essentially methods or tools that can support or help explanations. So I would not view them as full explanations in the social sense, in that they're contrastive and everything that can be learned from these other fields, but they're tools that support explanation in some form of the other. Or the other. And actually in this field, we have several tools. So for instance, if we're given an argumentation framework, an explanatory tool or a method to support explanations can mean as that a set of arguments, for instance, here A and C, they both signal in some sense why, for instance, C can be accepted, for instance, if it's an admissible set, or the way we heard in the previous talk. So this was a different way of selecting sets of arguments. Then we also have this kind of more dialogue-oriented scenarios. And something I will talk here much more is, for instance, considering sub-frameworks, and that they offer in some way a tool for explanations. Then there are also some other interesting forms, for instance, summarization, where we actually compact part of the argumentation framework into one single node. So for instance, if this is one single node, then E is still accepted, credulously, for instance. And some other forms, I will not talk too much about them here, just to have a very small non-exhaustive list. So there are many forms that have already been studied, for instance, abduction, as I said, game theoretic forms, and so on. And there will even be at least two talks at KR next week about explanations. So maybe there are actually more, but these two I actually found with respect to explanations within argumentation. And probably the next talk in the survey, so I guess it's a survey, you will even hear more methods, it is, I guess. Okay, so now, but what are we talking about here? So as I said, we're talking about here credence acceptance under this admissible sets, or actually mostly admissible sets. And the view is here that we are given an argumentation framework, and this argumentation framework represents all arguments that are available. So there are no unknown, let's say, arguments that are not part of this argumentation framework. And what the aim for here is we want to identify parts of the argumentation framework, so as a sub-framework that already entails the answer of credulous acceptance of an argument. And here on the bottom, I just recap the definition of credulous acceptance in case you want to see it formally. Okay, and before I want to go to that, so Nico and others already talked a bit about complexity. So for instance, we know already for some years now that credulous acceptance is NP-complete under admissibility. So this means that the task of deciding whether an argument is credulously accepted or not is NP-complete. So should we care with respect to explanations or explanation tools, should we care about results like this? So for instance, one can argue, well, this is just about computing, Yeah? For instance, SAT solving is already quite efficient. And NP-complete problems can be solved, at least in many cases in practice. So I think also for explanations, one should at least take it into consideration. But first, of course, the very intuitive point is that, well, if you want to actually implement design an algorithm, it's useful to know the complexity. But also, if we look at the decision problem of credulous acceptance, then well, the outcome is yes or no, right? Yes, it's a credulous accepted. No, it's not credulous accepted. But this is not one can argue that this is not a particularly good explanation or tool for explanation. It's just a yes or no. But what the complexity also tells us, at least in a general case, there is no, and under some assumptions at least, there is no, in a sense, witness for the negative case if the argument is not credulously accepted, because then the corresponding problem is actually co-NP-complete. So is an argument not credulously accepted, it's a co-NP-complete problem. Then in general, under some assumptions, of course, under the complexity theoretic assumptions, there is no witness that's actually bounded in size polynomials bounded in size with respect to the input argumentation framework under some assumptions. So for instance, there's no witness, so that's a linear sized set of arguments from which we in polynomial time can derive whether an argument is credulously rejected or not. So and this can also affect our tools for explanations. And so for instance, just a side remark, for instance, in SAT solving, so for the no case, they actually look for proofs, and these proofs might not be, at least in a general case, might not be polynomial in size. Of course, in explanations, it's also the case that, size is not an absolute measure of quality of an explanation, right? So small witness doesn't mean, so smaller doesn't mean better, yeah? But it might still mean, as I think also Annemarie argued for, that in some cases, small witnesses in some form or the other can be useful. Okay, so much for a purely complexity theoretic view. So I briefly already talked about it, but so our view here is that we look at sub-frameworks that already entail the answer of credit acceptance or not credit acceptance. So here you see some induced, so let's see, this is our original Amplitude framework, and now these are three sub-frameworks induced, for instance, here by the set E, so this is an E, and here by the set D and E. So what is a sub-framework here induced by a set of arguments? Here we just collect the arguments within the set and all the tags, so all edges within these between these arguments. Okay, and now we see some form of reasoning that's present, for instance, in the credit acceptance view of under admissibility. These Amplitude frameworks are in general, they are non-monotonic formalism. So for instance, here in this Amplitude framework, E is incredibly accepted because there is an admissible set containing E. Still, so if you just compact it to just this argument E, throw everything away, then we also have, in a sense, a witness of credit acceptance of E. So one can do this. It's not inherently bad, but if we, in a sense, expand again to up to the original framework, then we might come across Amplitude frameworks or sub-frameworks where E is not credit accepted. For instance, here the only admissible set except the empty set is a set containing D, for instance, not E. So it might be that you have in a non-monotonic fashion acceptance, rejection of your arguments, of your created arguments. And this in a sense, also based on some earlier works, leads us to the, in a sense, main form I want to look here today, which is we termed strong explanations. The term strong mainly comes from strong inconsistency in non-monotonic formalisms, and we borrow this term here. If you don't like the term explanation, you can also view it as a strongly accepting sub-framework if you prefer these terms, but I will stick with the term strong explanation in this talk. So what is a strong explanation? So so for a given semantic sigma, so for instance, admissible sets, preferred complete extensions, stable extensions, and so on, so stable semantics. So it's a subset of the arguments such that for each sub-framework induced by set E prime that's between this set S and this and the original upper bound, let's say, of the original Amplitude framework, there is there is a sigma extension E that contains my argument. Now let's go to an example, and probably it becomes clear in the example, or at least more clear. Okay, so here in this original Amplitude framework, so if I consider that our set S is the whole set of arguments. Well, here there is no like sub-framework in between the full one and the full one. So we just have one Amplitude framework here, so one sub-framework. And here E, for instance, it is credit accepted because there is one admissible set containing E. In this framework induced by the set A, B, C, and D, there is no admissible set containing E simply because E is not even part of the sub-framework. And so of this sub-framework, so it is present of a super-framework. So if you re-add E again, but it's not part of all sub-frameworks induced by the set A, B, C, and D. Similar here, in this, for instance, if you set S to D and E, then the sub-framework induced by this set S, well, it contains one sub-framework between this set here and going back to the original one. So there is one sub-framework where E is not credit accepted, in particular, even the first one, even this one here. Okay, and so these were two negative examples which are not strong explanations under admissible semantics for E. Let's look at two which are, for instance, I think I forgot the D. It's okay. Sorry. Here we have this set A, C, and E. Well, here in this subframework and in all super frameworks up to the original one, there is an admissible set containing E. So, simply for instance, if we add B again here, then we have this attack and this attack, but E is still unattacked. And if we re-add D, for instance, then C is a defender of D. And if we add both of them, then we are again at the original framework, and also E is Kratos accepted. And now let's look at the potentially more interesting example. I will tell you in a moment why it's more interesting, at least from a theoretical perspective, or at least from a certain perspective, I mean, is this sub-framework induced by C and E. So if it now, if you write it like this, so here's, this is the candidate for a strong explanation. And I can query the argument E. So here in this framework, there is an admissible set containing E, because E is just not attacked. And if we do not add in the super frameworks the argument D, well, then in all of these, there's a single admissible set containing E. So let's not consider these anymore, because these are kind of, in a sense, trivial. If we now go this route and we add D, well, then C is a defender of E, and we have the admissible set C and E here. And now if we still add more, for instance, B, for instance, then here we have that B and E together are an admissible set. This is not an admissible set in the original framework, because it actually diverges here, but in this particular subframework, it's still an admissible set. So it means in all super frameworks of this framework, including this one, up to the original one, we find some admissible set containing E. And the interesting thing is that C and E, for instance, does not even constitute an admissible set in the original framework. Yeah? So strong explanations, strong sigma explanations, strong admissible explanations for a given queried argument. So they might actually be smaller in this case than admissible sets containing E. For instance, here in this original framework, the smallest subset, the smallest admissible set, actually the only admissible set containing E is the one with A, C, and E inside. And here we have one strong explanation that's actually strictly smaller than this admissible set. However, if we, in an intuitive sense, if we accept these two arguments as given, that any re-expansion to the original framework leads to a situation, to an argumentative context, if you will, that we still have to accept E credulously. Okay. Okay, so might be slightly over time, but I think it will manage. So we'll not talk too much about the negative case here, but one can also, so I want to mention that one can define the strong explanations or the strongly rejecting frameworks also for the negative case. And here we essentially just switch that in each induced sub-framework, there's no sigma extension that contains my argument here. This is, in a sense, the negative case. But I will not go over the framework here in interest of time. So now I already told you that the strong explanations are not necessarily sigma extensions. So strong admissible explanation is not necessarily an admissible set. But there are actually connections between sigma extensions and strong sigma explanations. In particular, under quite mild assumptions, which actually holds for all the standard Dungian semantics of stable, preferred, complete, grounded, and admissible semantics, it is the case that each such sigma extension is actually a strong explanation. So in this way, it holds, but it doesn't hold in the other direction. Okay, and if you now take a slight step back and a few both actually strong explanation and sigma extension in a more general terms, and we just say, let us consider some set of arguments and some target set X. So before it was just one argument, but we can generalize it to a set. But if you prefer it, this can also be just one argument here. So if we take a step back and have a more general view, so for instance, so before this could be, for instance, a set of sigma extensions or a set of strong explanations for some semantic sigma. But now I will just view it as a general set of sets of arguments. Then we can give such sets of arguments properties. So I mentioned here two. So one is a very basic one, which just means if some set of arguments is in this calligraphic S, then this implies that there is at least one sigma extension in the induced subframework of this set that witnesses Kredlos acceptance of the set X, or just one, if you have just one argument, just the argument A. And the another property is the we termed monotonicity. You can also view this as upward closure. But so if some set is in this calligraphic set S, then also all supersets up to the original set A are also within this calligraphic S. And then one can show that actually if such a calligraphic set, so calligraphic S, so set of sets of argument S, satisfies both this property under some semantic sigma, then actually each member of the set is also a strong sigma explanation. So this means in a sense these two properties characterize strong explanations. Okay. Another point one might actually wonder, so if you have a strong explanation, for instance, for admissible sets, is it the case that such a strong explanation is conflict-free? Well, in general, it cannot be because it's upward closed. That means if you have some strong explanation, that also each superset up to the original set of arguments is a strong explanation, which means that you kind of necessarily come across conflicting sets. But if we now consider even minimal sets in this in such a calligraphic S, or if you will, a subset minimal strong explanation under some semantic sigma, then it's actually the case that strong explanation don't even satisfy, in this case, conflict free. So it's a bit more complicated, the examples, you can find it in the reference paper. So it's this one, but I will not go over it here in this talk.
Can I maybe ask a very quick question?
Yes.
Is calligraphic S here now the set of all strong explanations, or is it still an arbitrary set as before?
So here, this property still refers to arbitrary sets, yes.
But then we can just take a singleton for calligraphic S of all the arguments, and then we immediately have the result, or? I mean.
So this is phrased for arbitrary set of sets of arguments, but if you now view strong explanations, then the strong explanation as a set of sets of arguments, this does not.
Okay.
Sorry for the confusion
it's clear.
Better in the paper. But thanks, Bart.
Around 2 minutes.
Okay, then just very quick. Okay, so I already told you some of this table here, but you can find more details in the papers. We looked at some more properties, but I won't go in the interest of time over this. As a brief remark on complexity. So in general, if you want to verify whether something is a strong explanation or whether it's a subset minimal strong explanation, essentially the complexity at least increases by one level of the polynomial hierarchy. The proofs are a bit involved, but if you wanted more details, you can find them in the paper. So it's not trivial. And as a last result slide before the questions. So for the rejected case, not for the positive case, but for the rejected case, actually we and also some others, Niskanen and Jevesalle, actually performed experiments, so they implement prototypes, and we also did it. And for the instances from the argumentation competition, we actually found that in many cases the strongly rejecting, so it's the reject case, subframeworks were actually very small. So in many cases even less than 5 arguments. So there were really a few arguments that already entail non-Kredlos acceptance of an argument. This is the last slide before the conclusion, I swear. So here we talked about epsilon argumentation, but I just want to briefly mention, essentially, as Annemarie already said, so one cannot really stay in the pure abstract level, one should not, because some properties on a purely abstract level might not carry over, for instance, if one considers SBIC plus or assumption-based argumentation, and also the internal structure can actually be useful for explanations, and it's currently ongoing work to extend this to structured frameworks, but it currently, at least, it looks promising. Okay, so then I already stop in interest of time. Thanks for your attention.